Hello and welcome to my presentation on a comparison between free forages. In this presentation, we'll be comparing free forage species of legume. You'll cover red clover, better known as Trifolium pratensis, white clover or Trifolium repens, or bird's foot trefoil slash BFT, known as Lotus cornicalutus. You'll be comparing them in the context of its starch content, its frequency as a parasite host, the amount of crude protein and protein degradation, as well as the intercropping potential of wheat. Although this is only for red and white clover, since I was unable to find any useful information on intercropping with BFT. Since this is a pre-recorded video, this version of me will not be able to answer questions. You'll have to ask the real, not pre-recorded me that's less articulate. So without further ado, let's begin. Now let's start with white clover. We'll first cover some basic information regarding white clover. White clover is a low-growing, creeping forage legume used predominantly in pasture mixtures, often in combination with grasses. It's known to be a good means of improving forage protein levels in pastures, as well as supplying nitrogen for grass growth. It, however, is ill-suited for use as a cut forage due to the fact that it's a low-growing legume. As such, it's best suited for a pasture system. This forage legume persists for a longer period of time than both BFT and red clover. It is also moderately tolerant of low pH and wet soil. It is also not tolerant of drought and of medium vigor. White clover can also tolerate close grazing, but it's better if you allow the crop to recover before re-entry. It's a low forage yield in grass mixtures, but the added protein and improved nitrogen makes up for its drawback. Now on to the comparison side of things. DAAP has found that there's a high amount of starch concentration in white clover, and this has been linked with the diseases called EGUS and laminitis in horses. In a study comparing a close relative of BFT called Lotus pendulculus, Sulla, alfalfa, and a ryegrass white clover mix, and a red clover mix, it was found that Lotus pendulculatus and Sulla carry the least amount of gastrointestinal parasites found in lambs. Alfalfa had the most, and the white clover ryegrass mix ranked second. It was also found that both red and white clover had similar levels of parasite eggs on them, and less eggs than alfalfa. This seems to suggest that although white clover is not as effective at repelling gastrointestinal parasites as something like Sulla or Lotus pendulculatus, it is still pretty good in comparison to alfalfa. In yet another paper studying intercropping with organic wheat using white clover as a cover crop, it was found that the white clover did not actually accumulate N and actually cause nitrogen competition between the wheat and white clover, in which the wheat won out. Although it was not a complete failure, since the intercropping did allow for better weed competition. Now on to the traits of BFT. BFT is a high-quality forage legume that is well-suited for marginal lands, i.e. soils with a low pH, poor drainage, limited fertility, prone to heaving, etc., etc. BFT is more suitable to these adverse conditions. It can also reseed itself as a bonus, making it suitable for pastures. This forage has no to limited bloat hazard. The drawbacks of this plant is that it's generally slow to establish, slow to grow in spring, and slow to regrow. It also has limited palatability for horses. So you win some and you lose some. BFT comes in two specific strains, the Empire strain and the European strain. The Empire type BFT is a primary grazing type strain. It is useful for its fine stems and prostrate growth. It also has an indeterminate growth habit, making it well suited for pasture. The drawback of this is, of course, slower establishment and regrowth periods. The European type BFT is much better adapted for hay production since the strain is taller. It also has a faster regrowth and establishment rate compared to the Empire type. Now on to the comparisons. In a study similar to the one I referenced earlier, but by different researchers, it was found by comparing the parasite load found on white clover, alfalfa, and BFT. BFT had the most parasite eggs, surprisingly enough, considering in the Australian study, its closely related species had the opposite effect. Alfalfa came in second in terms of parasite load, and both red clover and white clover were tied for having the least amount of parasite eggs in that study. In yet another paper, it was found that there was greater protein availability in cattle with BFT than white clover, as well as a lower carbohydrate content. This is in spite of the fact that there's a low tannin concentration, which we'll cover a little bit later. As a result of this increased protein yield, it was also shown to increase milk production. In yet another study by Dr. Giras in 2013, it was found that red clover and BFT were roughly on equal terms in terms of crude protein. Now on to the topic of tannins. Tannins have been studied as a secondary metabolite that reduce protein degradation in the rumen. BFT is one such species that shows a low rate of protein degradation in comparison to tannin-free alfalfa. It's been shown that this is due to the fact that there's tannins within BFT. Red clover also has a similar trait, although it's because of a different mechanism, which we'll cover in the red clover section. But by slowing down the degradation of protein due to rumen activity, this would increase the amount of protein available to the cattle or other ruminant animals, which would improve the growth of the cattle slash other ruminant animals. Now on to the traits of red clover. Red clover is a short-lived perennial that usually produces 2 to 3 hay crops per year. This forage has rapid spring growth and very low winter hardiness, which contributes to this short lifespan. There's various growth habits of red clover ranging from erect to prostrate. It's the easiest forage to be seeded via no-till, and it's well adapted to lower pH soils than alfalfa. Unfortunately, there's been great difficulty in the drying and safe baling of this forage species, which limited its use for its purpose. Although it seems to do well as a silage crop, it comes in two forms, double cut or single cut. A paper by Bill Dean of the University of Guelph, shout out, has compared both types for drought resistance. It was found that a single cut growth type had higher shoot water content 4 days after being harvested and a higher shoot dry weight after 8 days compared to the double cut type. The conclusions from the study were that the double cut varieties were less drought tolerant than the single cut types. The likely reason for this would be the different growth habits of both strains. The morphology of single cut or mammoth red clover would be slower growth than the double cut, maturing 2 weeks after the double cut varieties, and this version will not flower in the seeding year, meaning you have to wait until next year before it flowers. It also will not flower until the first cut is done. The double cut variety is more vigorous in both regular growth and regrowth, and flowers more frequently. The lower amount of resources used by the single cut red clover would likely be the cause of its drought resistance. Now on to the comparisons between red clover and white clover and BFT. As said before, red clover is comparatively attractive to parasites as white clover, and roughly equal in terms of crude protein with BFT. It has also been found that much like white clover, red clover is not very competitive with the wheat when intercropped with it, and nitrogen fixation will be reduced in a relay system. although it's still very competitive with weeds. As was mentioned in the BFT section, red clover has a resistance to rumen degradation of the protein available, although the mechanism is different. In this case, the chemical propanol oxidase is found in the red clover plant, and this chemical reduces the rate of degeneration in the rumen. This chemical is known to deactivate plant proteases, which slow down the breakdown of plant proteins, increasing the amount of available protein content in silage legumes. This happens by the chemical binding to the quinones of the plant protease enzyme. However, polypenol oxidase is completely inactive in the rumen itself, so whatever protection happens must be happening outside of the rumen. Now on to the conclusions. Now at this moment, you may be confused and look like the cow in the picture. And you're probably wondering what messages to take away from this. Well, the first message is, if we are to rank these forage legumes by how few gastrointestinal parasite eggs are on them, for Canadian forages, red clover and white clover would be tied for first, alfalfa would rank second, and BFT would rank dead last. Both red and white clover have limited competitiveness with wheat, and you should not expect any nitrogen to be added to the soil via this process of intercropping. White clover has the highest starch content amongst the three listed, with red clover and BFT being tied for first in low starch content. Red clover and BFT are tied for first place in terms of high protein content and protein availability, albeit through different chemical mechanisms. Here are the sources I used for the presentation. Now it's at this point that I hand this off to RealMe, so that RealMe can answer the questions that pre-recorded me did not answer. Back to you, RealMe. Also, if you want to re-see this video, it will be available on my YouTube channel, Agri History, Saturday morning, or on my BitChute channel, also called Agri History, Friday afternoon. Thank you for watching.